Good morning. Welcome once again. Good to see everyone this morning. Glad that you could be here and that you chose to be here. It's good that we can be together. Beautiful Sunday. Getting a little bit cooler out there. We're hoping it'll get cold enough to kill some bugs, oak mites in particular, things like that. And I think that will come sooner rather than later. But we do want to. It's good that we can be here and it's good to see one another. Couple things just to mention. One, first I want to introduce Don and Pam Stewart. If you haven't met them yet, way back there right in sort of the middle, they would like to be considered members of 151st Street and work along with us. So we certainly welcome them officially. They've been meeting with us for a while, but now we can put them to work too. So glad to have you with us. One more time, remember, no services here tonight. Be meeting with South Point over at their location on it's basically just off of Warnell, Warnell and 133rd, I believe. The address is on the front of your bulletin, so you can take that with you. And if you don't do GPS and need a map, there are maps on the table in the foyer. Also, for next Sunday, not only is that a potluck Sunday, but we change times. We don't change times, but the world changes times, and we have to adapt to that next Sunday. So when it says 9 o'clock, it's really only 8 o'clock, so ladies have an extra hour to fix stuff for the potluck. So we planned that out very carefully and meticulously. God matters. When I was starting to plan this series of lessons on the topic of things that matter, the first topic that I thought of, the first one that I wrote down was this one, God matters. But then as I worked on things a bit, I debated whether to keep that one on the list or not. It's true that God matters. I didn't have any doubt about that. But I thought, do we really need a sermon about that? In a Sunday morning assembly of Christians, doesn't everyone already believe that God matters? The answer to that question is certainly a big yes. But just because all of us already agree that God matters, that doesn't mean that it's a topic that we can in any way take lightly or skip over. One reason to go ahead with a lesson on the idea that God matters is that even the most obvious truths need to be reaffirmed now and then. We believe it. We're going to keep on believing it. At least that is our intention. But if we don't reaffirm it, the distractions of life can gradually push it into the recesses of our minds. It's still there, but we don't really think about it or pay as much attention to it as maybe we should. Even as Christians, we can become so preoccupied with, even with Christian stuff, that we don't think often about such fundamental truths as God matters. If we aren't careful, we start thinking that, for example, going to church, that matters. Or raising our kids to be honest, productive Christian people, that matters. And those things do matter. But they don't matter more than seeing how much God matters. Another reason to go ahead and have a lesson on this obvious biblical idea is that it is truly the foundation of all the other topics, the ones we'll look at and others that we possibly won't look at in the series. So like the song says, let's start at the very beginning. It's a very good place to start. God matters. And if God doesn't matter, nothing else matters. So we have to start here. Every time we know that something is wrong, and we do it anyway, we are assuming, maybe subconsciously, but we are still assuming that God doesn't matter all that much. When we decide that we can get by with doing more or less what God says, instead of exactly what God says, we are acting on the belief that God doesn't matter all that much. Now, it's obvious that non-believers don't build their lives on the fact that God matters. The danger for us is to borrow just a little bit of that mindset, but not so much that we actually move into the other category of non-believers, but just enough that we allow ourselves to do certain things without thinking that even in these details of life, God still matters. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul was writing about the certainty of the resurrection. There were some people, probably Christians in Corinth, or at least people who were meeting with the Christians in Corinth, who were saying that there's no such thing as resurrection. So Paul followed their line of thought to its logical and erroneous conclusion. So to paraphrase Paul, basically he said that if there's no resurrection, we're just wasting our time. There is no good reason to do the things Christians do or not do the things they don't do if there's no resurrection. Let's just eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. The same thing is also true if God doesn't matter. All of the doctrines about resurrection and what comes after resurrection, they are all dependent on the doctrine that God matters. If there is no God, or if He doesn't have an impact on our world and on our lives, then nothing else taught in the Bible matters. What we believe and how we live don't matter if God doesn't matter. Our lives matter because God matters. Our faith and our hope for life in heaven matter because God matters. Our trust in God that our sins are forgiven doesn't matter if God doesn't matter. Everything that we believe matters in life is dependent on the truth that God matters. We're going this morning to look at three relatively well-known, famous Bible verses or passages that together give us an overview of the truth that God matters. We will start in Genesis 1, verse 1. Then we'll go to the passage that was read before the lesson this morning in Hebrews 11, and especially verse 6. And then we'll look at John 3, 16 in the context of why God matters. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. We believe that what the Bible says is true. That's the main thing, but there's more involved than just the veracity of what is said. The Bible tells a story, or we can describe it by saying that the Bible is a message from God to man. But there's more in the story than just a collection of facts and anecdotes. There's also something in the way the story is told that adds to its power. That this statement is chosen as the opening line of the story helps us understand and appreciate the story. This is a great opening line, especially in light of the story that follows. We call this Genesis 1:1. We could just as well call it Bible 1:1. Bible chapter 1, verse 1. Because there is nothing said anywhere in the Bible that matters if verse 1 doesn't matter. You may have some favorite Bible verses. Verses that bring you strength and comfort and encouragement. Or verses that keep you from messing things up more than you do anyway. None of those verses matter if the first verse doesn't matter. Any value that those verses bring to you is an illusion if this verse doesn't matter. Think about the story that unfolds after that first verse. We have the story of Adam and Eve, the story of their sin, the consequences of their sin. If God didn't create, all that is a fairy tale. And if God didn't create, there's no such thing as sin. And there's no such thing as being separated from God because of sin. The Bible tells the story of God working to guide mankind and to restore a good relationship with us. That story doesn't matter if verse 1 doesn't matter. It matters if God is pleased with us or angry with us if He created us. If He didn't create us, it doesn't matter what He thinks, if He even thinks. I found an interesting quote as I was studying for the lesson. It says, "How ironical is the dehumanizing influence of humanism?" Humanism is defined as a variety of ethical theory and practice that emphasizes reason, scientific inquiry, and human fulfillment in the natural world, and often rejects the importance of belief in God. In other words, by saying that God doesn't matter, men have attempted to elevate mankind to a higher status than he would have if there's a God. The irony is that in denying the role of God in creation, man has actually reduced himself to an accidental blob of molecules. If God doesn't matter, then we don't matter, because in that case, we are nothing but matter. If God created us, then he matters, and so do we. Hebrews chapter 11 is the great chapter about the importance of faith. The assumed truth of Hebrews 11 is that God matters. Because if God doesn't matter, then faith in God doesn't matter either. All of the examples of faith that we find in the chapter are stories of people for whom God mattered. And not only did it matter that he existed, but it also mattered that he was active in the world in a way that responding faithfully to him also mattered. Hebrews 11 starts with this intriguing description of faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. This is another place where we have to be careful that the break between the chapters doesn't obscure the message. The last section of the preceding chapter, of Hebrews chapter 10, is about how much it matters to remain true to God. For example, Hebrews 10:31 says, "It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God." The living God is the God who matters. Dumb, lifeless idols created by the imagination of men don't matter, but the living God does. So the chapter, that's chapter 10, ends with a plea to the readers. "We are not of those who draw back to perdition, but of those who believe to the saving of the soul." Unless God matters, that statement is nonsense. If God matters, then that is a monumental statement of a valuable truth. On that basis, the writer of Hebrews then reviews some things that matter. Verse 3 is a restatement of Genesis 1:1. "By faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible." That's actually an application of the statement made in verse 1. Faith involves the substance or the assurance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. We aren't asked to believe based on nothing. We look at that which was created and we see evidence of a creator. The magnitude and the complexity and even the efficiency of this world is evidence of a magnificent creator, even though we were not there to see him do it. That God created the world matters when we depend on him for anything. The examples he gives, for example, Abel. Because he believed that God had created the world, Abel understood that it mattered how he responded to God's instructions. In verse 5, Enoch believed in what God had done, and on that basis he believed in what God would do. He was faithful to God, and God rewarded him. And that leads to verse 6, which states that faith matters, because God matters. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. If God matters, or put it this way, if God is, it matters that we believe in him. If he isn't, it doesn't matter what we believe. But we should not believe only that he exists, but also that he rewards the faithful. There is a reward coming. Notice that verse 6 links the beginning with the end. It matters that we believe that he is, meaning that he existed before creation, that he created all that is. That looks back into history. It also matters that we believe that he rewards those who diligently seek him. That is looking towards the future of eternity. Because God matters, we should believe in creation and we should believe in the eternal outcome. Now, it's obvious that that statement, that idea, would resonate with the first readers, the first audience of the book of Hebrews, that is, Christians of a Jewish or Hebrew background. But the same message was presented to a thoroughly Gentile audience as well. Over in chapter 17 of the book of Acts, Paul was biding his time in Athens, Greece, the center of ancient philosophical thought. The place was loaded with pagan temples and pagan idols. And for Paul, those were gods that didn't matter. But he took the opportunity then to teach the people about the God that did matter. The God that matters was the God that created the world and everything in it. So in Acts 17, beginning of verse 22, then Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are very religious. For as I was passing through and considering the objects of your worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' Therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing, I proclaim to you, God, who made the world and everything in it, does not dwell in temples made with hands, nor is he worshipped with men's hands." He didn't quote Genesis 1:1 because that was a Jewish writing that probably didn't matter to the people of Athens or to most of them. But he affirmed the same fact. And if he was right, it mattered. Pagan worshipers went to temples to offer gifts that they thought their gods could possibly use. Paul told them about the God who didn't need anything they could offer because, in fact, he gave them everything they had. He said, he gives to all life, breath, and all things. And he goes on, in him we live and move and have our very being. Because God matters, it is in our interest to seek him and to seek a right relationship with him. But then Paul moves from the idea of God as creator to that of God who rewards those who diligently seek him, as we just read in Hebrews. So in verses 30 and 31, toward the end of the chapter there in Acts 17, Paul cuts to the chase. Truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. If God matters, then judgment is coming, and we need to be prepared. Because God is the one who will judge, he matters. If there's anything obvious in a courtroom during a trial, it is that the judge matters, and God is our judge. Over and over again, everything in the Bible, every detail of the good news, depends on the idea that God matters. In other words, anything that really matters, matters because God does. God matters because he sent his Son to die for our sins. John 3:16 is probably the best known verse of the Bible, with maybe the exception of 23rd Psalm. And both of these passages illustrate the idea that God matters. Psalm 23 says, "The Lord is my shepherd," and then goes on to describe how his shepherd takes care of him in all circumstances. It matters that we have a shepherd who can and will do that. Psalm 23 is based on the truth that God matters. John 3:16 affirms God's love for us. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life." The Bible doesn't spend much time proving the existence of God. As we've already said, it starts with the statement that God created the heavens and the earth. The existence of the Creator is treated as more as the self-evident truth announced by creation. On that basis, we can say that if God does not exist, then reassuring verses such as John 3:16 are meaningless. If there's no God, then he doesn't have a son, and he didn't send his son to do anything for us. But the Bible actually approaches these ideas from the other direction. It doesn't really go to prove God. It works on the basis that he is real. God exists, and he matters because he sent his son to die for our sins. God exists, and our sins separate us from him and earn us eternal punishment. Therefore, God matters because without him, our situation would be hopeless. God matters because he sent his son from heaven to die for our sins so that instead of eternal punishment, we can have eternal life. That kind of God matters. In a sense, the book of Romans takes the theme of John 3:16 and expands upon it. Romans emphasizes the fact that we are all sinners. Romans 3:23, "All have sinned, fall short of the glory of God." It also says the wages of sin is death. That's Romans 6:23. "The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Because of that, God matters. Without God's love and without God's effort, we are doomed to spend eternity in hell. But through the life, death, and resurrection of Christ, he offers the gift of eternal life. If God had not intervened by sending his son, we would have no hope. God matters. God matters because without his word to guide us, we would be lost with no alternative, with no other options. The prophet Jeremiah admitted to God that without God's help, we wouldn't have the vaguest idea of how to live on earth, let alone live in eternity. He said, "O Lord, I know the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man who walks to direct his own steps." Psalm 119, verse 105 adds, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." Without God's word, we can't know how to live right. And we might learn a little by trial and error, but it's a slow process and not terribly efficient. Even with God's word, we struggle. Without it, we wouldn't have a chance to figure out how to live right. God's word shows us where we are, where we are going, and how to get there. We looked at 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 last week, but we need to look at those two verses again. "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work." This is not a threat that if we disobey God's commandments, he'll get angry and punish us. This is giving us a remedy for our problem. We need help to know how to live right. We need help to know what God has done for us to offer us eternal salvation. This passage says that God's inspired word teaches us what we need to know. That's one more reason that God matters. God matters because only He can instruct us in righteousness. All of the themes of the Bible are woven together. In the beginning, God created is the starting point. But then we see the earthly damage, not to mention the spiritual damage done by sin. Then the Bible teaches how helpless and harmful man is to himself when he turns away from God. It teaches how persistently God has worked to save us from our sins. It is all one amazing story. And every item in it declares that God matters. God matters because He created the world. God matters because He gives commandments and instructions to help us live better lives. God matters because He knows we sin anyway and acted through His Son to forgive our sins. God matters because He is the one preparing for us a place in heaven. There are big details and there are little details in the Bible. Even the little details are indications that God matters, but the big ones really show that God matters. And the biggest detail is that our Creator sent His Son to save us. He wants us to believe that He matters and that His Son died for our sins. When we believe that, He calls us to respond in a very simple way. He doesn't require that we conquer all of our sins before we have any hope. But He calls us to commit ourselves to resisting temptations and to turn away from sin. That's what we call repentance. And then He says to be baptized. And when we are baptized, that's when God has promised to forgive us. When we're baptized, we are saved and we become children of God. If you have not confessed your faith in Christ, if you have not made that commitment to turn away from sin, and if you have not been baptized, then you urgently need to do that. And if you need help living as God calls us to live, then let us know so that we can try to help you. If you need to respond this morning, please do so. Let's stand and sing.